Welcome to Film with Family. My name is Zach.
And I'm Austin.
And we are two cousins talking about movies. Today we're bringing on my older brother, Caleb, to talk about one of his favorite movies of all time, Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. Gonna be a good talk. All right, we have our second guest on Film with Family. It is Caleb Zweifler. He is my older brother. How you doing, Caleb?
I've got a little bit of the sniffles, but otherwise I'm doing just swell.
Good to see you, Caleb. My cousin.
Mine cousin.
My cousin?
Yeah, when we had Drew on here for The Whale, we kind of forced him to watch The Whale, but... You know, we thought it would be nice for our family guests to let them pick the movie that they're going to talk about. And when I asked you what we should do, you said right away, Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. There's no hesitation.
I mean, for a variety of reasons. One, because it feels to me like a perfect film in my estimation. Part of it's for its time, and part of it is timelessly like a perfect film. I think the how it's estimated is controversial, and I've heard many people talk shit about that movie, and I'm willing to enter the Coliseum of debate with anybody that has denigrating words about this movie, because certainly no other Robin Hood movie compares to it, except maybe... The only other two ones that I feel like did a decent job were the cartoon. I assume it's Disney with the Fox.
Yeah, the Disney.
Yeah, I saw that one really late in the game. For some reason, we didn't watch that as kids, but I probably mainly like that just because of the Roger Miller soundtrack. I think that's who did
that's
it.
That's nice. Roger Miller's dope.
The opening of the animated Robin Hood is so good. The music is so great.
Yeah.
And they like the rooster that plays guitar and introduces the whole story.
Robin Hood and Little John walking through the forest, laughing back and forth at what the other has to say. Reminiscing this and that and having such a good time. Oodle-lolly, golly, what a day.
Yeah, I don't know how that wasn't part of our like, rotating. It seems like a no-brainer because I loved Robin Hood and I like animation and it's a great movie, but...
Our parents messed up.
Yeah, the other one that I think it deserves recognition is Men in Tights, obviously, Mel Brooks. I feel like that, and I'm pretty sure a lot of the jokes that they make reference Prince of Thieves specifically. I enjoy those three the best, but there's so many horrible Robin Hood movies, especially contemporary ones that came out not too long ago that...
Yes, the Ridley Scott one with Russell Crowe comes to mind.
Yeah, that's garbage. I mean, it's really easy for me to just go right into the deep end with this. So why don't we take us? If there's, I don't know if there's another intermediary step before.
Well,
just get in the whirlpool of it.
Well, Caleb, I would like you and Zach to just kind of describe the scene as a child and how you were watching Prince of Thieves, how you first saw it. How you were first exposed to this movie that came out in 1991, and you were born...
I was 89.
89, okay.
And that was 92, so it was a year before me.
So, like, was this movie just in your house by the time you just started having...
Yeah.
...reforming thoughts?
Yeah.
Yeah, we had on VHS.
Yep.
Then we got on special edition DVD later, I remember.
Yeah, but I know we put the VHS through the ringer. We had to get the tracking lines sort of in sync. But my mom's a huge Kevin Costner fan in general. Like, she loves Dances with Wolves and...
Field of Dreams.
Field of Dreams, Robin Hood. It's It seems like Zach doesn't. I mean, you've obviously seen it, and I know you like the movie, but I don't know if you watch it as much as I did, or like when was the last time you saw it before watching it recently?
Yeah, it's been a long time. I haven't really reevaluated much as an adult, but yeah, there's rewatching it again last night. It all came back to me. Like, there's so many quotes and moments that I just knew in my heart because we'd watch this shit all the time,
Yeah.
and we would. And I remember when we got the DVD, we would just cut to like our favorite fight scenes, like the Little John fight. We would watch that scene over and over in the siege. And the final showdown, like we would just throw that on, get hyped.
Yeah.
Yeah, but what drew you to this movie originally? Do you think it was just something that because your mom loved Kevin Costner, it was just in the house and
I don't know. I think we were indoctrinated into it. Like my mom got me like one of those little suction cup arrow toy bows that I would shoot at the fridge. Not long after that, or simultaneously, Robin Hood proceeded. Like what she her hack for a movie that was too explicit for children would be, she would let us watch it, and then once it would get either to a sexual scene or something too scary, she would just run in front of the TV and start dancing and like just doing something distracting. And we're like, oh, what the heck? And then a few minutes later, she would just move out of the way and we'd keep watching it. But she definitely was like, the violence in that movie, while it's not super gory, it's pretty dark, especially by Robin Hood standards. Like it's one of the grittier interpretations, I feel.
Yeah.
Yeah, that little kid gets hung by the rope, and yeah, there's some pretty good kills in it.
The very first scene is pretty
Yeah.
violent when he's
Yeah. They
in the
set the tone.
dungeon with the really long beard on and the long hair,
Yeah.
looking like a bum and almost getting his hands cut off. The other guy, I think the other guy does get his hand cut off, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So did you just watch this again, like last week or something, or yesterday?
I watched it 2 days ago,
Nice.
and it's probably the first time I've watched it since watching it at your house when I was a child. Because I honestly, my only encounters with this movie have been through you guys. Is just remembering being a preteen or a teenager and just going over to your house, and it's like, oh, I guess we're watching Prince of Thieves again.
Yeah,
Because there wasn't really much else.
multiple
well, that
times.
was probably like mom probably got it started, and then all subsequent, like that was me enforcing watching. It's like I don't know how it doesn't get more recognition. I'm in a bubble, I think, of Prince of Thieves.
Well, hold on. Let's back up a little bit and just explain where Prince of Thieves comes in the timeline of our lives. It's 1991. This is a Warner Brothers Morgan Creek film. At the time, it was the competitor against Terminator 2, and
Same year.
same year, same summer.
Wow.
And Terminator 2 actually beat it just by 40 million. So they were pretty close contenders throughout the summer. And Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves ended up grossing like $164 million, which I guess at the time was, this is a weird factoid, but it was the second best opening to date for a non-sequel.
Robin Hood was?
Yes, Prince of
That's
Thieves.
great.
Yeah. Yeah. And, of course, one of the other big things with this movie was the Bryan Adams song, Everything I Do, in parentheses, I Do It For You, which doesn't make an appearance in the movie at all until the credits, but there is a motif in the score that keeps coming back.
Yeah, it's like the love theme with Marion. Yeah.
Don't tell me it's not worth trying. No, it's true. Everything I
that song is one of the best selling singles of all time. It's sold 15 million copies, and it's actually just behind Mariah Carey's All I Want for Christmas Is You.
Wow. Just, that's insane.
Yeah.
I never would have guessed that.
Yeah.
The context of this movie, I think it's important that you're establishing that this, like, it's not even really 90s because it's so early. It's really more informed by, like, the late 80s.
Yeah.
And the aesthetics of that time and what was cool. Like, I feel like the weird mullet thing he has going on and,
yeah.
Like, the big hair, the,
uh-huh.
Obviously, that song, it's super tacky, but, like, for that time, it's like, it makes sense that that would be super popular. I didn't think that it would be Mariah Carey level. That's crazy.
Well, also, if you look at just 90s movies in general, there was this trend of movies and pairing it with a really successful single. Like, you've got Titanic, the Celine Dion song,
yeah.
And actually Kevin Costner's movie The Bodyguard obviously, yeah, set up the single. Like, I don't know what it was about Kevin Costner and hit songs, but they paired together well, I guess.
Yeah, it's going to be really hard. Maybe you guys have enough notes. To be honest, I did not rewatch that in the last week, but I feel like before we even did this podcast, I'd watched it probably a couple months ago.
Yeah.
So, like, I tried to find, like, a list of scenes, but I could, if you just mention anything, I could go on. And the weird thing is it's beyond just the scenes, there's just elements of this that make it so good. And one of the main ones is Kevin Costner. Like, what is it about Kevin Costner? You know, everyone talks about the accent. He kind of does this half-ass, like, not even really British, but just sort of, like, not quite American, but most of the time he's just being himself, which, you know, if you're a purist, I think the majority of Robin Hood depictions up to that point were very theatrical and kind of lighten the loafers there for do a little billboard. Like, for, like, it's men in tights. It's not, like, super, it makes sense that it's around the same time that Terminator 2 is coming out and these big budget action movies were, like, this is it's an action movie, but, and it has all, like, amazing choreography. And I could talk so much about just the fight scenes and the way they approach them. That's incredible. But what I think that, like, you could have found a million British actors that could have, you know, had an appropriate accent. But do they bring the X factor that Kevin Costner does? And I don't think they do. It's a matter of, like, is he selling the scene? Are you buying it? And for me, I might be brainwashed. Kevin Costner, I'm buying all of his shit in this movie.
Yeah, I'm brainwashed too. I just love this movie. Too much nostalgia to see this movie objectively.
I'm biased, but, like, when he's, when the main thing is, like, it's distilled, like, what is it really? When he's pulling back the bow and he's staring with focus at his target, does it look like he's not fucking around? And, like, you look at Russell Crowe, you don't buy it. That other British guy that they had, where they actually had a really legitimate archer, you know, train him and try and set up historical ways of archery. The movies, I mean, they had bad scripts. They had a lot of problems, but one of the things they didn't have was fucking Kevin Costner.
Yeah, he sells the action. I think that's when his performance is best, is when he's in an action scene. He's just in it, and he's got those steely eyes, and he just looks so good pulling that bowstring back.
Even when he's being charming, like as a romance companion to Maid Marian, he has great chemistry with all the other actors.
Azeem, he's great buddy chemistry.
Oh my God, Morgan Freeman. The cast is incredible. Like, if you just take Kevin Costner out of it, it's got some of the best, like, one of Morgan Freeman's best roles.
My personal favorite, Alan Rickman as the Sheriff of Nottingham. He is so fucking good in this movie. My favorite Alan Rickman performance of all time.
He's hamming it up.
I know. Yeah. He's giving you a big ham sandwich in it. I mean, every bite. It's so fucking good. He's got every line reading felt iconic to me rewatching it. It's like,
yeah, he's got all the accent you need. He's got the movie covered.
Well, Alan Rickman apparently turned down this role twice. And
what?
They begged him to be in this movie. And they said, basically, if you join this cast, we will allow you to do whatever you want. You can go crazy. You have carte blanche. And so that's the performance that you see. And a lot of his most classic lines, like,
cancel the kitchen scraps for lepers and orphans. No more merciful beheadings. And call off Christmas.
That is all ad-libbed. Or when he walks out in that same scene and there's those two girls and he's like, uh-huh. You 10:30, you 10:45. And
bring a friend.
Bring a friend, yeah.
That was improv.
Yeah, that was improv. And,
yeah, I remember that coming up in like the bonus features we had for the DVD, and it was like, Alan Rickman, he's a fucking badass.
Yeah.
He's so good.
And it's rumored that Kevin Costner actually had some of Rickman's scenes cut because he realized that Rickman was upstaging him.
Are you serious?
Yeah. And as far as Kevin Costner and the accent, you know, I wouldn't even say there is an accent. It's like he's not trying at all. And I guess, so again, another rumor that
I
heard.
In the beginning of the movie, he kind of like a little bit. Not,
yeah,
it's like an affectation. It's not really an accent.
The story behind that is apparently that he wanted to use an English accent, but Kevin Reynolds, the director, didn't want him to. And so, like, he would try to throw in his accent when he felt like he could, but it was like he was sneaking it in, because apparently Costner claimed that he hired a dialect coach, but then they, like, stopped it because they thought that it was just like not working
bad.
Out. He wasn't.
No,
yeah, it was
yeah.
just like, this is not gonna work.
That was a great choice.
Yeah,
because it's like you would focus on it, like leaning into it would be way more obvious, and be like, you know what, fuck it, he's just off the
yeah.
grid. Like,
yeah. And the same thing with Christian Slater.
I know, and that's another thing, they don't really point out that there's a lot of American people. I mean, I guess Azeem has an accent. He's a more
You got to admit, it does stand out that, you know, you go, oh, these blinds, and then Kevin Costner's like, hi, I'm Kevin Costner. Like,
well, the
just
reason the reason why it doesn't, and this is because, again, it comes back to that mission statement. Like, this is, I feel like, it's like a spaghetti Western where Americans are making a British iconic story,
mm-hmm.
and our guy is American, and like the stuff, the way we're going to present this is going to be in a Hollywood way, and some of it might be a bastardization. It's obviously going to be more bombastic. I think it's consistent with the overall motif. It's not but in other ways, like, it is. It's not like they didn't have an attention to detail. One of my favorite things, I think this is a good, if we want to start creating, like, moving through the plot, one of my favorite things about this movie is the way it starts. And the first scene is a, like, a historical tapestry of, you know, of that period.
The Crusades.
Yeah, even though it's the story of Robin Hood is mythological. But it's so cool because that's, like, it's setting, like, the tone of, like, okay, this is where we're getting taken to this time period. And it's also married with, I really don't like long intros with a bunch of credits for the most part. But this one, is because it's introducing, in my opinion, that everyone talks about Bryan Adams, but Michael Kamen is the best score of any, like, medieval style, like, and better than Lord of the Rings, better than some of my favorite Star Wars, like, grand sweeping compositions. It's got amazing songs.
Yeah, it starts off with the main theme. The main theme is such a ripper.
when I was watching the movie, that main theme of the score, I was like, they use this in other movies? Where else is this coming from? And I realized that this movie did so well and was probably Morgan Creek. It was their most successful film. So if you watch the Morgan Creek like intro, they use the Robin Hood soundtrack. So that opening, like I've seen that in a million movies because it's the intro to the Morgan Creek logo.
Well, I knew that, but I thought that I didn't realize I've never seen another Morgan Creek movie, so I didn't even know that. Like, when did that company?
I don't know.
I wonder if they had intros
Morgan
prior
Creek
to that
saga. But hold on, let's see. Morgan Creek movies.
Did they do Waterworld? Because that's also another Kevin Reynolds movie.
Probably.
And Kevin Costner.
They did Ace Ventura, Pet Detective.
Right.
Bringing that up again. We talked about that Ace Ventura in the last episode.
Yeah.
They did Major League, True Romance, Last of the Mohicans.
Okay.
Yeah, so a lot of... Oh, they did Nature Calls, too.
No, you're right.
They've produced a lot of different movies.
And they always use that theme.
But yeah, I think we had the soundtrack to this movie on CD or tape, because I just remember mom picking us up from school and like blasting this soundtrack, like coming home from school and stuff. Like we were just like, this music was always around. We were just like listening to the soundtrack.
It's not just the overture. There's so many like builds and like just subtle moments, and then like the rising action. Additionally, it is definitely a movie that got me into archery, and definitely some of the most satisfaction I got growing up was shooting my bow, listening to the soundtrack at the same time, and just like getting totally in the geek mode of just, it's almost synonymous with archery, the what it evokes kind of spiritually, that music to me.
Yeah, can you talk a little bit about your history as an archer? Like when you got your first bow and how you started to get into that? And was it a direct, like you loved Robin Hood so much that you wanted to pick up archery?
Well, I can't think of an archery movie that preceded it. I know that like anytime it was in anything with a bow and arrow, I was intrigued. When I know that I got a resurgence when Lord of the Rings came out and the crazy shit they had Legolas doing in Fellowship of the Ring. But traditional longbow, some recurve. I got, like I said, it started with the suction cup bow when I was like a little kid. And then when I turned 13, my dad commissioned a neighbor of ours to build me a bow. And that was like my first real bow. And
how old are you?
13.
So like the Thunderbolt one?
Yeah. Which sadly that one actually got splintered. I brought it with me when I was traveling one time and is all black with this sort of Native American-esque look to it.
Yeah, sick paint job.
Yeah, it was a mind-blowing gift. And one of the things that, that could really derail us thoroughly if I go on a full archery tangent, because there's so much of it. But one of the things I think, to do a quick synopsis, that this movie inspired was like thinking of modern day archery. The majority of people use compound bows, which are great for hunting and target shooting, but it's a very singular, slow, methodical, precise alternative branch to philosophically use it. And my fascination with the bow, I've never gone hunting. It's something that I want to get into now, but I always target shot since I was 13. But the way I would shoot was something called instinctive archery, which in a lot of ways was just not kind of teaching myself and learning some bad habits. But my frame of mind was like not thinking about how accurate can I get this one shot and take all day to aim and you know, be all calm and centered. It was like, what if eight guys, like, what if I was in Robin Hood? What if there was orcs everywhere? I have to get good at reloading arrows. I have to be efficient at, like, the speed of, that's what I thought, like, the mechanics, the beauty of archery isn't necessarily to me about, like, getting a million bullseyes in a row. That can be impressive. It's way less impressive with a compound bow. If you think about it as a weapon and not just, like, a thing to hit a target, a thing to defend yourself with, and how it's still a highly effective thing to use. It's silent. You can retrieve your ammunition. It's very lethal. And it's just one of those perfect technologies that, like, before that, and in my opinion, it's one of the most influential inventions in the history of mankind. Because if you think of how we had to procure protein up to that point, you'd have to run up, for the most part, with a spear, maybe throw a spear, drop rocks on something. Once you start getting bows, it changes how you hunt. It changes war, bow hunting on horseback. It just gets on and on, crazier and crazier. And there's so many levels. Every culture has a different sort of expertise and what they were good at with bows. Some bows require, like, insane, like them Viking bows. They're like 180 pounds to pull back. Like, I couldn't even pull a bow back to the war bows that they use to shoot these shafts that are so thick that they can pierce armor. I'm gonna cut myself off, but, like, I could really, I'll just say that this movie, yeah, not only did it inspire my initial interest, I would say to a large extent, in archery, but it really provided the framework of reference of, like, what is it, how is it used, what are the possibilities, and a lot of it is Hollywood. Some of the things that he does are exaggerated, but I really appreciate the shit out of those things, even if they're a little bit crazy.
Some of the great archery moments in this movie are, like, when Kevin Costner pulls the arrows out of his quiver and, like, stabs it into the ground, and then, like, kind of has, like, some quick arrows right there. I like when he, like, he bites the feather off, like, one of his arrows and does the, like, awesome, like, double shot. Gets two guys off a horse.
Caleb, can you explain a little bit why he would slice off the feather? Like, why didn't he just put two right next to each other? Like, do you have to bite off the feather? Does that make it, like, so it turns to the left or the right or something? Or,
well, in theory, the feathers definitely contribute to the stability of the flight. So they if it doesn't have feathers, it is more likely to sort of flop around the shaft. So they're playing around with the idea that if, you know, if he's so good that he would rip off an arrow, because you can only aim in one spot, but he knows that if he rips off one feather, that it's going to peel the direction off in another way, to the point that it could do a split shot, which I do have some arrows that have a missing feather, but that to me feels like a little bit of some Hollywood action, but it's like, it's got enough of its foot in
reality and physics. Yeah.
Yeah. Cause there's another movie that does the same thing where they sort of think about physics in terms of, like, it's a Korean War movie, I believe. It's called, like, War of Arrows, another really ridiculously high grossing movie, but the guy, like, twists his string with his wrist to the point that when he lets it go, that it would add, like, an additional kind of torque, and so the arrow can actually curve and steer, which is
not realistic.
Neither of those are realistic in the sense that, like, I don't think that it's replicatable, but it's like, yeah, if you get rid of a feather, it would manipulate how it would fly. But I like the fact that one of the reasons why that last thing that you mentioned, the three arrows in the ground thing, I didn't really appreciate this until I watched it as an adult. But, like, the fact that what's going on in that scene is, you know, a bunch of Celtic barbarians are going over the walls into Sherwood Forest, or not the walls, the hill, and you know, Robin of Loxley is immediately realizing, here's a massive army he knows that if he doesn't take firm directive action in that moment, they're going to get completely slaughtered. And yeah. as a leader, and in keeping with the theme that they have from the very beginning of the movie, when they grab his arm and, you know, they say something about him and he's like, I'm going to show you British courage or something, English courage. He talks about courage throughout the thing, and exemplifying in that moment is like, I need to storm the front, even if it's by himself, and I need to show that we can kill these things and that we need to be brave or we're going to fucking all die. And yeah. the way that it coincides with the perfect musical hook, it's such a bad, it gives me chills. I could watch that 10 times in a row, and then it's always badass. It's so good. And it puts into the practice that idea of, like, efficiency, arrow, knock, shoot. Like, I love that. It's rapidity.
Mm-hmm. A few other things about just the arrow. The famous flaming arrow shot, it was shot at 300 frames per second, which I don't think many movies were shooting at that high of a frame rate yet. The first time we see Robin Hood with an arrow is he picks up a crossbow just out of nowhere. How the hell did he get that crossbow? It's like when he's being like approached by all of the sheriff's kind of like lackeys when him and Azim are walking in the beginning, and then
I'm pretty sure that he gets it from the first guy that's like terrorizing the kid in the tree.
Kid, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And
the guy he ends up born.
Yeah, he gets in a skirmish with him and busts his face in with the crossbow, and then he kind of sneaks it. Yeah, so I think he gets it from that first minion.
Yeah, and that is the sheriff's cousin.
Yeah.
Right?
There's some family connections in this movie. I was like, the sheriff.
Yeah, because he keeps Alan Rickman's like, cousin, hello, cousin.
And Sean Connery is cousins with Lady Marion.
Yes, Sean Connery making a very short cameo at the very end of this movie.
Yes, King Richard.
I'm just going to keep throwing trivia out there.
All right.
Sean Connery was not the first choice. Kevin Reynolds wanted it to be John Cleese.
Oh, that would have been so good.
I know.
I mean, Sean Connery's great, but that's amazing.
But Kevin Costner insisted on Sean Connery, and so he shot for one day and got $1 million.
Nice. Make that quick mill.
Yeah. Like two I lines, $1 million.
I knew it too when I saw that. I'm like, that's half their budget is him just walking into this.
Well, no. So the budget of this movie was actually $48 million, and they made $164 million. So it was a huge success.
Yeah, there's also the brother thing where they find out like Christian Slater and Robin are brothers.
Yeah, that's a great twist.
Yeah, I think that's Christian Slater's best scene in the movie. He's like, he really is delivering the emotion of that scene. He's like freaking out and crying, and
he shoots him in the hand.
Yep.
Another great.
What's that all about?
One of my favorite archery shots too in the movie. Because he was gonna throw his dagger at him, and right. is like A, self defense, and B, like, again, setting the tone, because it's like if he's gonna let, you know, one of the merry men kind of question his authority, then he's not gonna have any chance of being a leader. So he had to kind of be a little firm fisted with him.
I guess so. And Little John, just speaking of challenging, that the
he's
fight
great.
Scene between them, gotta say, Little John kind of kicks Robin Hood's ass.
Oh yeah.
And Robin Hood, quote unquote, wins by just like sucker punching him from behind twice. Like the only times he gets
a ball shot.
Yeah.
Yeah, the surprise ball shot out of the river, dude.
I know, but like the two times he gets Little John is like he just hits him from behind. Total cheap shot.
Yeah, the first one is a really funny one. It's like a big wide shot. He just like runs up and like smacks him in the back of the head with a stick.
I know, but it's just like after he hits him in the balls, like Little John just gives up so easy. He's like, all right, you got it. And everyone's like, wow, he's the best. It's like, dude, Robin Hood just got the shit kicked out of him by this guy. Like, how does he have any respect from the Merry Men after that, like, poor performance?
Well, I think it's a couple things. I think it's one that it's, you know, I was just listening to some commentary from a recent big boxing match. And they talk about, it's a common theme of fighters, like, even if you lose, if you took a licking and you kept fighting.
Took a licking and keep on ticking.
Yeah, like, there's a lot of respect that he garnered through that. And also, he made him yield because he doesn't know how to swim, which is a conceit, I believe, that's consistent in all the Robin Hood movies that I've seen, is that some reason he's this big guy that's really fearsome but doesn't know how to swim, and you know, he's by a river all the time.
They have that great scene in Robin Hood Men in Tights when he knocks him into the creek and he's like, I can't swim.
Yeah,
and he just looks at the camera like, okay. This is another interesting fact, is Cary Elwes, who is Princess Bride and the Robin Hood and Men in Tights, he was actually the first choice for this role, and he turned it down because he didn't like the script.
That's crazy.
And then he gets to do Men in Tights 2 years later.
It makes me wonder what the script is like, because
I mean, I think you see it. It's not much change.
Well, it's a good script, but it's like, what really, like, again, it's the culmination of factors. Like, they did an amazing, like, the people who worked on this movie, you could tell it was a passion project. The costume design in this movie is incredible. The music's incredible. The
great locations, on location shooting. They get some beautiful look, like that first, or like that weird little hill that Azim and Robin Hood around when they first get to England, and they're like talking about, like, oh, what do you know of women? That whole scene, I really love that location.
Yeah,
I'm a sucker for green hills.
Cinematography is great. I can't really think of an aspect of movie making that, like, they don't excel at in the movie.
Yeah, some would argue that it's too long, but I can't see it any other way. But yeah.
Well, it doesn't, yeah, my memory of it, I think I just saw, it's like 140 minutes, so it's over 2 hours. Back then, that was too long. Now, that's short movie, almost. Like.
Well, I will admit, Caleb, watching this movie felt like a long slog for me. And yeah, I at like 45 minutes in, I checked the time, and it was like, there's still an hour and a half? I was just like, oh my God. And so I don't know. I feel like it is very long movie.
Yeah.
Too long. I would just say too long.
There's things that could get trimmed down in theory to make it more accessible to more people. Definitely, if you look at what I remember of the extended sort of special edition DVD thing, a lot of that, it's like, yeah, it's a good thing they cut that stuff, because I mean, I guess it's interesting for super fans like us, but doesn't add to the overall quality. And a lot of the things, I mean, I would like to go, I couldn't find a scene-by-scene breakdown of the movie, because I don't know what I would cut in retrospect. I feel like maybe some stuff with more Tiana, the witch.
Well, that is one of the things they cut, is some sort of reveal that Mortiana is the Sheriff Nottingham's mother.
Yeah, I remember something like that.
Another family connection.
There you go. Yeah. What does it say here? It says, Mortiana explains that she killed the true George Nottingham as a baby and then replaced him with her own infant son, revealing that she is the sheriff's real mother. Yeah, the witch is very interesting character. You got that milky eye going.
She's got a red eye and a white eye. Very cool. She freaked me out as a kid. Like, I couldn't, those were the scenes I like would leave the room for. It's like, oh, she creeps me out too much.
Mom would jump in front of the camera for a lot of that.
Yeah, because yeah, it's a little too scary for me, maybe.
That, like, she, yeah, they could have, like, used the bare minimum of her, I feel like, because, you know, there are some plot points that, but it's also an excuse, like, she's really just, like, someone that Alan Rickman talks to, like, and you get more of him. What I love about it is, like, every main cast member has at least one scene where they steal the show, in my opinion. Like, Little John has a couple where, like, the times where his family's in jeopardy when the trees are burning and his wife and baby are in the thing and he's, like, you know, screaming at her from the other end. And then
that whole scene is really, I think,
so good.
The centerpiece of this film when the Sheriff of Nottingham burns down and ransacks the Merrymen's forest village.
Yeah, I love that moment and that siege where they start busting out the fire arrows and start lighting, like, all the houses on fire.
Cannonballs, flaming cannonballs, and everybody's just on fire.
Yeah, you see the Sheriff of Nottingham, like, he's just, like, picking something out of his teeth, like, while, yeah, like, the siege is going on, like, he doesn't give a fuck. Like, just, like, a little moment like that just makes me love the sheriff even more.
The one question I had with that is, so everybody's running for their lives, everything's on fire, Little John's in trouble, but Robin Hood is just dumping gold coins out. What, why was he doing that?
I think it's just dumping
money out. Like, it's just like, dude, you're Robin Hood. Let's, you know, put out some of these fires, save a few people. He's like, no, I got to get rid of this cash.
I think the idea is, like, their home is now fucked, and it's like, take what money you can, because the sheriff and the, like, they're gonna take everything. At least if you have some coins in your pocket, then you can, like, survive a little bit wherever you end up going. That's what I always sort of interpreted as.
I thought it was him distracting the greedy enemy by them, like, running around and them stopping and being like, oh, gold coins.
I think that's what kind of happened, so yeah.
Is that what happened?
Like that, okay. The Celtic soldiers started grabbing at the coins, too. I don't know. It is a weird moment a little bit, but they don't linger on it for too long.
Yeah, I was just like, what are you doing, dude?
You know, stop. Yeah, you should, like, start shooting people, but...
Yeah. Can we talk a little bit about Friar Tuck?
Yeah, the drunken Friar Tuck.
I think he's a great character.
He's great. Oh, my God. Yeah, talk about his scene-stealing moment. It was when, with that fucking, like, priest guy. That's probably the best line in the movie, is when he's like,
here's 30 pieces of silver to pay the devil on your way to hell.
He smashes him out the window.
To pay the devil.
Yeah, he fucking rules.
That actor is Michael McShane, and I recognized him from Office Space. He's the hypnotherapist, you know, that dies after he hypnotizes the main character in Office Space.
Yeah. He also breaks the fourth wall at the end of the movie. He talks directly to the camera.
Oh, that's crazy,
like,
yeah.
Gives a little wink to the camera.
That's what I love about it. Like, these are the things that people, like, can complain about, but it's like, yeah, but that's why I like it. They take these, like, stupid...
It's campy, yeah.
Yes, yes. They lean into it. It's great.
And that scene, though, when he's like, you may kiss a bride, and he's like, I know that.
Kevin Costner says that?
What is that line? It's like him trying to do, like, a Han Solo, like, I know.
Yeah. He improv'd, like, that.
It's just, like, not romantic or witty or anything. And that's the one complaint I have about Costner's Robin Hood, is he's not that playful, he's not that witty, which I think is, like, the main tenet of the character of Robin Hood. The only scene where he really feels like that is when they're robbing from the rich.
Yeah.
When he's, like, in the tree and he, like, just kind of sneaks a bag of coins, and then he goes up to that girl all smooth and he's like, you don't need this ring.
Yeah. I truly hope so.
Yeah, other than that scene, there's nothing really, like, endearing about him. He also seems kind of stupid. Like, when he's like, looking through the telescope and he's like, oh, yeah, they're coming, and it's like, And even Morgan Freeman's character is like, you're not that smart.
Yeah. I guess. I think that's what they're clearly... It's like a good cover song. You don't try and do... replicate exactly what was successful about the first song. You try to deviate enough that it's your own thing. And I feel like that's what they do successfully. Because, yeah, we've seen the, like, witty wisecracking.
And the green tights. Yeah, he's not doing that.
He's got some good witty remarks, but like, what are more successful are the times that he's like clumsy, like when Friar Tucker kicks him in the face and he falls off the wagon, and he's going back to like to kind of like size him up and be like, what the fuck, and his bow and his quiver is all like fucked up around him, and he's just like, fucking fuck this, like, and yeah. I love heroes that are like that, where what's heroic is not necessarily that they're always graceful. I think that is endearing, that to be the, like, the clumsy, like, action hero,
but also just straight up dumb. He asks the blind guy to look after Maid Marian. He literally says, look after her, he's blind.
Yeah, Duncan. I love Duncan, though.
Duncan's great.
He kind of looks like Willie Nelson a little bit.
Immediately, she gets captured. Like, just immediately.
Yeah.
It's like, that was a bad plan.
I love how when Duncan comes back to Sherwood Forest, how their alarm signal is those, they have the arrows with the whistle attached to them. That is
just
so
shoot
cool.
It like near him.
It's like,
yeah.
Yeah, going back to that scene with Friar Tuck when he gets knocked off the wagon, and then Robin goes up to him, is like, well, do you yield? And he's like, I'd rather roast in hell, tries to bite his leg. That part gave me a good laugh, just like Friar Tuck tried to take a chomp out of his leg.
Friar Tuck is wasted.
Yeah.
All the time.
He's a lush.
I like how he quickly assimilates to the outlaw band, too. He's like, he's very against it. Then he's like, he seems buddies with him pretty quick, which is cool.
He's drunk.
Yeah.
I think the example I was thinking of, not so much with the sequels, but Casino Royale with Daniel Craig. I remember really liking that movie. And part of it was that same kind of thing of like getting away from like, the sophisticated, like, yeah, like, he was still witty, but he wasn't Pierce Brosnan. He wasn't, like, he was this, like, rolling down staircase, brutal, kind of clumsy, but also, he was intelligent, but you make some valid points, but I think that adds to the endearing rather than take it away, in my opinion.
Fair enough. Yeah, so speaking of Pierce Brosnan, I have to play you this clip. So Pierce Brosnan did a made-for-TV, or he was the host of a made-for-TV documentary about the release of Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
What?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
His delivery on every single segue segment where he tees up the next part is so overdramatic, and he is just chewing the scenery and just like talking with so much praise about this movie, like it's going to be the next fucking Citizen Kane. It's like tomorrow the world will be changed.
A legend that will live on forever. And tomorrow night, with the premiere of Robin Hood, the Prince of Thieves, Kevin Costner will be the next to string the bow, ignite our imaginations, and continue the legacy. Long live Robin Hood. I'm Pierce Brosnan.
This is like Tim and Eric.
It's so funny.
Like, it makes me wonder how much they paid him to do this, or what kind of like stimulant he was on.
It makes me feel like, why didn't they choose Pierce Brosnan to play Robin Hood? He would have been fucking amazing. I bet you that's like why he did it so well, because he was like, I should have been fucking Robin Hood. I'm going to show you right now that I should have been Robin Hood. Because, like, his voice is perfect for it. I could totally see him, like, killing it as an action star. Like, he makes so much more sense to me as a Robin Hood than Kevin Costner. But Kevin Costner had the star power, so, you know, I don't think Pierce Brosnan had really done anything at that point.
I mean, I think he would make a great Robin Hood in a different movie. It would have to be a like, you'd have to write it different, and it'd have to be approached differently. Like, if you put him in the same movie, I just don't think he could carry it.
Fair enough. Agree to disagree. So the first time you see Robin wearing a hood is when he goes into the castle to tell kind of Maid Marian his plan when they're standing at the candles. And then as he walks away, she's like, "Hey, and Robin, take a bath."
She doesn't say it like that.
No, she does.
She and says, then, "Take a bath."
And so, so this ties in with my favorite scene in this movie.
The waterfall scene.
No. Well, that too. But when he just grabs that pile of shit with all this might. When he just grabs that pile of shit with his hand, just that big steaming pile of shit, I lost my mind laughing.
Wait, when does that happen? I don't even remember.
It's before he goes into the castle and he's posing as like a blind guy. That's how he gets in. It's like the guards like, "Get the fuck off me. You smell like shit." And he like lets him go through.
But they... Oh my God, Zach, you have to rewatch the movie.
He gets a fistful of horse manure.
He just puts his whole hand in that. It's like, I understand what he's going for. It's like, he couldn't have just like rubbed his sleeve against the pile of shit or like just kind of like nudged into it a little bit.
That's what Pierce Brosnan would have done. Kevin Costner goes whole fucking hand.
He
gets his under his fingernails. In between the finger, the webs of his fingers.
Yeah, it's like he just...
He wants to activate all the stench in it. He wants to break it up and just release the odor.
It's what a hero would do.
Yeah, he is a bit of a bimbo now you mention all these dumb things he does in the movie, but...
That's not dumb. It works.
What's funny, too, is, like, the guard sees him and... He's like, "Wait, you look familiar." And he's like, "Wait, hold on. You smell like shit. Go away." But it's like the movie gets it all confused because that scene was supposed to be in the beginning when he's trying to break into the castle to talk to Maid Marian. And so that's why she says take a bath, is because he's supposed to be stinking like shit during that scene. But they, like, because of some sort of continuity thing or that they couldn't explain how he got into the castle, they, like, rearranged those scenes.
Really?
Yeah.
Where did you see that? Some Wikipedia?
Yeah, I just looked it up. But I wrote it down because the pile of shit scene just stood out to me.
What's great about that is that's where you really get an unfiltered... vision of what his British accent was before the director's like, "Don't do that." Because when he says, he's like, "Oh, pardon me, I'm just a blind man." It's just like, that's what he would have done the whole movie. He does it just for them because he's like trying to be a different person.
Yeah, that's such a good point. Talking about Christian Slater and his approach to being English, that one scene where he says, "Fuck me," he cleared it.
Yeah. After they both get catapulted over the wall, they throw in the one F for the PG-13 movie.
Christian Slater just ad-libbed that, and the director thought it was funny, so he was like, "I don't care that it's historically inaccurate. We're just leaving
that
in."
It's so fun. It's so fun. They're always doing what's most fun. They don't care.
It's just it's a good time.
It's on that precipice because so many of the elements of the movie are so sophisticated and so well executed that it's like you want to start criticizing this as high film, but it's really just an action movie. It's a really fucking good, like, when action movies were good. I think I remember asking our mom or Aunt Donna for Austin about this, like when he's trying to get that shot in the tent scene with the hanging boy,
shoot the rope.
You know, he misses, and the guy, like, comes up and, like, tries to fuck with him, so he has to, like, he gets distracted and has to jump down. And, like, he knows, like, if he doesn't fucking, like, make this next one, he's just gonna fucking hang. So he just, like, licks the feather a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, what is that about? And my mom was just like, "Eh, it's just, like, a little good luck thing." And I'm like, that's exactly what that fucking is. It's not even anything. Like, it's meaningless, but it's like he's putting extra stink on it, kind of like a pitch.
Or like, yeah, like spitting on a ball or putting a little chalk on your cue.
Yeah, yeah, I love that shit. And I don't know, my mind's a little bit distracted. I'm still in like early parenthood mode, so like I'm getting sleep deprivation. But the I'm being revivified with the enthusiasm of this movie. So my brain's not working, but I have energy even though I was about to sleep 3 hours ago.
Caleb, you should just we should just say, Caleb, you just had a baby boy a few months ago.
Yeah, December 30th.
Sailor Delta Mark Zweifler is in the world right now.
New family member.
New family member and a new page in the Zweifler generational book. And so what's it like being a parent and how are you going to teach your child archery and teach them the ways of Loxley?
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to infuse as much of my things that I'm enthusiastic about as possible, but I also want to, like, whatever they're into. If he wants to be, you know, a little, like, warrior, I will totally support him in that quest, but if that's not what he's about, that's cool, too.
Yeah, I was thinking about you and the baby one. Little John, when his wife, there's a little birth scene with that, but then like he grabs the baby and he presents it to everybody, raises him up, he says, "My son."
Yeah, that's totally what it feels like.
Did you do that when Sailor was born?
If I could have paraded around with him and yelling and hooting and hollering, I would have done that, but it's a very interesting way to like just take the baby from the mom and just start parading through the drunken revelry with this. Like the umbilical cord's hanging off. He's like, ah!
Yeah, lifting him up like he's the Lion King. My son!
Yeah, that's great, though. He's one of the great, and I feel like he's one of the, I presume, he can't be American, because his English dialect seems really authentic to me.
Nick Brimble.
Brimble. He's got a great face. Just a very friendly face. You just want to give him a hug.
You got balls of solid rock.
There are some great character actors in this movie. One of the guys, Brian Blessed, who plays Robin's dad, who gets attacked by the KKK in the beginning of the movie. So he actually almost died shooting that scene. I guess in the first take, when he charges at all of the guys in robes, the horse bucked him and he fell and the horse fell as well and like came like inches from crushing him. And
is that the scene that or the take that they used?
No, so he just got up and did it again, and it's,
I can't believe
they didn't
use a stunt double for that.
Yeah, that guy almost died.
I believe it. With the Robin Loxley's dead, that's another part. A lot of like the really grisly parts of the movie that are, I don't think you see that in any other Robin Hood movie. Like when he sees his dad when he gets back to the castle and he's up in that like torture device and he's like all burned to shit.
It's pretty brutal.
But before I forget, that one of my favorite things about this movie is the final sword fight with Alan Rickman. And I think it is just a masterpiece because, you know, you don't really appreciate it as much when there's so many great sword fighting scenes in cinema. Like there's tons in Princess Bride, you know, some of the Star Wars movies, there's great choreography and the lightsaber stuff. But like what I love about this one is it's so realistic. Even if you were a trained knight, if you're using those heavy of swords in a confined space like that, where you're, you know, desperately like fighting for your life, it would not be pretty at all. And I love that it's just like they take turns losing their weapons, tripping, throwing shit at each other, like dodging behind shit. It looks like almost like two brothers like fighting each other, but with like much more dire consequences. The fact that there is choreography to it, but it's so much more chaotic, and because of that, like, it makes you as an audience member like, dude, you don't know what the fuck's gonna happen. You feel like someone's head's gonna get cut off at any minute, because it's not like, ugh, Perry riposte. You know, like, it's very down in the dirt. Like, I think it's brilliant.
And I guess Alan Rickman broke 10 swords doing that scene.
That's so dangerous. Just breaking a sword I would hope that they wouldn't have, like, you know, actually sharpened blades, but, like, do you remember that old video that was like that infomercial guy that's testing that katana. And it blops off and it like goes into his like main artery, and like he's just like, oh, that.
Yeah, that's like some clip we pulled off Ebub's World that we'd watch all the time.
And the nice thing about these practice katanas, oh, that hurt big time. A piece of that, just the tip just got me, Odell. Oh, that got me good.
You all right?
A piece of that tip just got me.
Oh, folks, right now, we may need emergency surgery in the studio.
oh my God, that's
what I'm saying. Like, that, if he broke that many swords, that could have easily happened.
Yeah, but he's really swinging that, and he's got a huge sword. And like,
it's
in the story,
ridiculous.
It's Robin's dad's sword, so it has that extra stink to it that he's like attacking him with his father's sword, which is kind of badass.
Yeah, it's a claymore.
But it's... also when Robin gives him the stab in the chest when he's like distracted with Marion or something, and just like how drawn out his death is, and he's like drooling from the mouth.
Yeah.
Like, I love his death. It's just like really ugly, and he does a great job dying in this movie.
And he's just like gasping and like crawling towards the light of the window and air and stuff.
Yeah, it's great.
The way he like turns back and looks at her like, ugh, the blade I gave you.
Yeah.
But again, Costner against Rickman, it looks so bad. Because Rickman is just bringing it. He's got the whole kind of medieval vibe. And I forget what he says, where he's like, I've got your father's sword. And he's like, well, I've never been afraid of my dad's sword.
He was such a, like...
That was actually a pretty good Costner there. That was good.
He says, I'll never fear my father's sword.
He does not say it like that. He's like, I never fear my father's sword. I never fear daddy's sword.
His voice is cracking. What are you talking about?
I'll never fear dad's sword.
Caleb won't stand for this blasphemy.
I'm not saying it's Rickman level, but it's not like that.
But there's another scene like that when he escapes from the chandelier and
That's
Rickman
awesome.
Goes... Oh, no, it's great. And then Rickman goes, I'll cut your heart out with a spoon. and then it cuts to Costner, and he's like, then it begins.
You have it so much higher in the tone, right? Then it begins. That'd be funnier if he did say it like that.
It's just the comparison of the two of them.
Why a spoon?
Yeah, it seems like that line, I'm going to cut your heart out with a spoon, is just like a one-off line, but then there's like a later scene with him and his cousin talking about why he wants to do it with a spoon. Like, he just keeps talking about how he wants to cut it out with a spoon. It's pretty funny.
He has to justify it.
Yeah, he brings it up to everybody he meets.
I guess the only other scene that I really want to talk about is Maid Marian peeping on Kevin Costner's bare ass.
Skinny dipping.
That's actually another, I really like those two, like, numbskull guys that are like accompanying her thing.
You can't do that. Come back here. Come back here.
Those guys are great.
Yeah, they kind of remind me of Hobbits a little bit. One's got kind of a Mary and Pippin vibe.
Totally. The only thing I remember about that scene is I was like, why is his ass so bleach white?
Well, like, I don't think it was Costner.
Why not?
I think it was a body double.
I think that was early CG, and the white part was just like they didn't know how to do the color match.
It was animatronic, actually.
It was Photoshop.
Oh, there's a couple quotes I want to pull out that are really ingrained in me. Like, there's that when Robin's like talking to the outlaws, and at one point, one old guy goes, "We ain't got nothing to eat."
Yeah, that's such a great delivery.
I feel like me and you would quote that line all the time.
It's such a great point.
Yeah, and he's just got such attitude when he says it.
Yeah,
and also just like the guys going, "No blades, no bows, leave your weapons here." And just like, that really was burned in my memory. Like them just repeating that. Get some troops in here. the Sheriff of Nottingham.
Yeah, there's so many. What's one of your favorite lines, Caleb? I'm sure it's hard to choose.
You'd almost have to go by character. I mean, I love the jingle. There was a rich man from Nottingham that tried to cross the river. What a dope, he drifted on a rope. Now look at him shiver. Beg for mercy, rich man.
Yeah, that's Christian Slater. In the river scene, that I love that too.
But that's the introduction of Little John too, right?
He's like, "This is precious to me. It's precious to us too, mate. That gold medallion, a fetus for a blooming month."
Yeah, that whole scene is just perfect top to bottom. I love that location. That's a beautiful like little river location, and they introduce all the characters so well. Perfect fight scene.
Stick fighting would just fucking suck. Like when he clips him in that uppercut right in the fucking face with thick ass sticks with a huge dude.
Hey, Drew Blood, he did.
What else we got? Morgan Freeman.
Yeah, the thing I like about his character is that he has this whole thing of, you know, Robin Hood saves his life in Jerusalem, and he has this thing that's like, "I'm gonna stick around with you till I pay this debt where I have to save your life." And there's like so many situations throughout the movie where Robin Hood's in peril and Azeem doesn't do shit. And Robin Hood goes up to him, like, "Why didn't you do anything? I thought your old deals were supposed to save me." And he's like, "Nah, I'm waiting."
Yeah, I fulfill my debts when I choose.
Yeah, he like doesn't do shit the whole movie until at the very end when the witch comes out of nowhere and starts screaming, and then he throws the scimitar at her. That's when he pays the debt.
Doesn't she actually like run into the spear? He kind of sticks the spear out.
That's before that. And then he thinks she's dead, but then she pops back up after Sheriff Nottingham's killed.
Oh, right. And then he throws. Yeah.
Honestly, as much as that fulfills his debt, that to me was the part that, like, if I was going to put something on the cutting room floor, like her jumping out again after getting impaled. I mean, I get it. Like, if she's a witch, she might have some, like, stamina that's, like, otherworldly, but, like, just the whole like overhead throw, spinning sword, it hits her. She goes flying. It's fucking ridiculous. Like, it's such a weird.
It's kind of got some Tarantino ridiculous energy to it.
and it's because, especially because we already got the action climax resolution that we needed. And then that happens really abruptly. And then it goes into, they're like, Marion and Robin are just like, "That was fucking crazy. Oh yeah, I guess we got to start kissing each other now." Like,
yeah,
it's so weird. I don't know. It's such a weird, bold choice that I feel like, because when Alan Rickman's like, after they get, you know, married, shotgun wedding or whatever, and he's basically like attempting to rape her, and then like
awful, upsetting scene. That's what I would cut all that shit.
I mean, it should be though, is because that's what happens in the story. Is like he's trying to. She doesn't want to get fucked, and he wants to fuck and, like, consummate the marriage or whatever. And, like, the how he's like spreading her legs, and then he's like, oh! He goes over through the window.
It's so bad, though. I mean, the way that they're like, she's ripe, and like,
oh yeah, they really,
and yeah, the way that he like spreads her legs is like traumatic. I was like,
I'm not saying I enjoyed that, but
I mean,
I feel like
obviously he's a villain. But I think that we've already established that he's a shitty guy by that point.
But he has to consummate the marriage in order to make it legit. It's a legal
thing. Because he
wants
one pure thing, right?
Yeah, I love that line. He's like, I only have one thing that's pure in my life. Don't you interfere with it.
Oh, yeah, that's the one thing they say about Maid Marian and Robin. Like, I guess they were friends as children, and it was like, you burned my hair as a child. Like, you burned her hair.
Yeah. Well, I can kind of see that, how like kids don't know how to, like, when they like someone, they like do stupid shit.
Right.
That's like, but
that's a little extreme though.
It is. I remember when I was a kid, like in first
you
grade,
lit a girl's hair on fire.
No, I remember throwing sand at her. Like that was my move. I'm like, she's gonna think this is fun, like, and she's like, what the fuck, and like ran away.
Yeah, but thankfully in your older years you've learned to be a wiser man. Whatever he says to her.
The problem with this is that, like, as much as we go through this, I know I'm gonna rewatch this, I'm like, oh, we didn't talk about that fucking shit, but I could talk about this movie forever, so it was nice to take a deep dive.
So Caleb, why don't you just give us your final thoughts on Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves?
Well, I would just say that we've established that I'm super biased. I was brought into it at an early age, and it had a massive impact on me. But I mean, I really like, you could make a case for all the silly things in this movie, and a lot of those are valid. But I think context and era is everything, and all the things that are a little bit rough, not even rough around the edges, but just like either like kind of like wincing with tackiness or a different approach than we've seen in the past. I think it's great. They take a lot of risks and they succeed in almost all of them. And the cast is great. The music's great. All these things we said. I would agree that it maybe could be a little bit shorter, but I don't know what I would cut for my benefit. It would just be for, like, if you're presenting it to a more broader audience. So I think it's one of the greatest films. It's in my top, definitely top 10 movies of all time, probably top 5. It just makes me happy. It's one of those things. It's not even a guilty pleasure. It's just a pleasure. It's a fucking great movie.
Yeah. Yeah, I was definitely feeling that rewatching it. You know, it definitely was your favorite movie, but, you know, I was always around when you'd throw it on. And then, you know, just looking at the VHS box or like the cover of it with, you know, the flaming arrow. And he's just like looking great on that cover of it. It's like, how could he not want to watch the movie when you got that sitting in your cabinet? Like,
his outfit's so cool.
You're going to want to throw that movie on. Yeah, I pretty much agree with what Caleb said. You know, it's definitely, I could see the critiques on this movie, but for me, it's just, I got too much nostalgia wrapped in it. I can't see it for anything else. It's just this movie that's part of growing up. And there's a lot of movies like that where I can't really give it a hard time for its flaws. Like, the things that I love that are ingrained in me overlook all that stuff.
I appreciate that, and I'll just say I can't watch this movie without thinking of you guys, because I really do think that the only times I've watched it were in the context of being at your house, and I'll just be honest. I mean, I didn't like it then, and I don't like it now.
There was nothing. You didn't get anything out of it. You didn't like anything.
No, okay. So I just will say,
you liked Alan Rickman.
I like.
You said that.
I'm glad I watched it, I've been like researching this movie for the last 2 days. I've been doing like nothing but think about Robin Hood. I'm just I've been doing my own deep dive because, and I'm really happy to get your perspective because it does make me appreciate the movie a lot more. And I think that, yeah, I think like in the pantheon of Robin Hood movies, you know, for my money, most Robin Hood movies just aren't that good in general. Like, I just don't think that's true. The story is that exciting. I like Men in Tights, but honestly, I was just rewatching it. I do think that I love the music in it. I forgot all about like the rapping choir.
Yo, yo, yo.
Check it out.
Prince John and the sheriff, they was running the show. Raising the taxes because they needed the dough. A reign of terror took over the land. They were shaking down the people just to beat the band. I said, hey.
Hey.
I said, hey.
Hey.
I said, hey.
Whenever I think about the tone of Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, I think of Die Hard.
Michael Kamen did the score.
And Alan Rickman.
Yeah,
the villain.
Yeah, it's true. So,
but like, it's really just like, yeah, it's like big explosions, fucking like late 80s, early 90s. There's a different thing. It doesn't work. It doesn't play right now in the same way. It doesn't hit the same, even though it didn't hit for you either.
Well, I mean, I just, okay, so my biggest problem with it is Kevin Costner. I think Kevin Costner is so wrong for this part. And it's not just the accent. I just feel like he is like a bump on a log and sticks out like a sore thumb. Like, he just does not fit in this movie. I feel like Cary Elwes would have been a better fit. I feel like Pierce Brosnan would have been a better fit. And also, Kevin Costner right now is at the height of his career. He's shooting Dances with Wolves, JFK, and this movie all at the same time, basically. And they only had 10, because he was so busy, they only had 10 weeks to shoot this movie. And you can just feel that it's really rushed. People like Alan Rickman and Christian Slater, like, use that to their advantage because they're like, okay, well, they're not going to throw away this footage. They don't really have any room to do it. I think that's why they, like, left in things like the fuck me line and let Alan Rickman just be as crazy as he wanted to. Because he added some humor to it. I think it's just kind of not a great script. I don't think that Kevin Costner is given like good Robin Hood vibes.
What I appreciate about this conversation is, A, I feel like it's given me acceptance to the fact that, because I've heard of these people that just don't, Kevin Costner doesn't work. And it's like, you know, fair enough. Like, some people, there's been things that people say is the best. I'm just like, I don't get it at all.
Well, and I appreciate your perspective because I think it's sort of cliche to hate on this movie.
Which is crazy. I can't believe that.
Yeah. I mean, I feel so like it's good. Cliche to like shit on this movie. Pretty much every review that I look up or on Letterboxd or on YouTube, people are just shitting on this movie left and right.
People don't know how to party.
I mean, I just definitely fall in that camp. To be fair, though, also just kind of like historical medieval aesthetic in general doesn't really jive with me. It sort of has a fantasy feel to it that I just don't really connect with. I never really like, I do love the Lord of the Rings movies, but I didn't get into them until like fairly recently. I wasn't able to really appreciate them until recently. And it took me a long time to get into Game of Thrones because of the same feel.
You're a city slicker. You're from Chicago. We're out country bumpkins.
You never been in the woods in your life.
Anyway, but I will say, talking to you both and the love that you guys have for this movie has definitely made me appreciate it more.
You got to admit, the score is good. You like the score?
I love the score.
You can't deny the score.
But I feel like I have more nostalgia with the score of it being the Morgan Creek opening because it like reminds me of watching Ace Ventura when I was a kid.
I think another thing that needs to be said is that this is something that goes across all movies or any story thing where an actor is involved. Being the protagonist, like being the Frodo, being the Robin Hood, being the main character, being Neo, it's almost impossible to do. Like,
a lot of pressure. Especially if you're doing a character from the 13th century. It's been passed down for generations.
Well, some of it's because it's like a lot of the things that are fun to play and somewhat easier to play are the colorful side people. And there's so many great side people in this. And like, I think for someone that allows all of those other actors to look amazing, like I really believe that if we could go back time, look at the footage for a Pierce Brosnan or any Robin Hood that you would like to be, I don't think the movie would have the zing that it has that Kev brings to it.
Yeah, I'm not going to argue that Kevin is great, but I do think, and I'm
it's
not
part
bothered,
of the magic.
I'm not bothered by him at all, and when he's in those action scenes, he's in it, and that's when I need him to be in it. And
yeah, dude, yeah, because like Carrie, you know, what is it? Ellis's last name?
Carrie Ellis.
Ellis, yeah. Yeah, he could do all the speaking things great, but like when he's sword fighting and stuff, you're like, it's just, it's, I'm not gonna talk shit about it. I'm not. I love Princess Bride.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just a different type of Robin Hood. That's it. Some people like
different.
It, some people don't.
Yeah, it's true.
Different. Apples and oranges.
It's true. I mean, Carrie and Pierce would be a little bit more frou-frou.
Dainty.
And dainty, yeah. I mean, Kevin Costner's bringing that Ford tough American.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I could see why, you know, if all those bad reviews were from Britain, they honestly get a pass. Because they have a right to be pissed about that. But, like, everyone in America would be like, fuck yeah.
No, I've seen a lot of Americans shit on this movie, too. But
It does make me want to go back and rewatch Waterworld. You know, it's the same director.
Yeah. And another terrible movie.
Another I didn't huge flop. Dislike that movie. I only saw it once and I was like, yeah. It was kind of cool.
Yeah. But I mean, like, I guess Costner did all of his own stunts in this. You know, he did the archery, did the sword fighting, he did all the swinging on ropes.
Horses.
I guess and there's that scene where he runs over like four horses and then jumps on the saddle. Like that was a pretty good stunt. Like when he's like, I forget what's happening, but he's running from somebody and he like literally like toe taps over four different horses and then jumps on one. I was like, okay.
Yeah, kicks the guy.
Yeah. He also does a little backflip off a tree branch. It's kind of fun.
Yeah. That was my favorite like Robin Hoodie moment of him is when he's like, hello, and I take your coins.
It's funny that like the like things that you think are stupid in this movie, like when you say what you liked, it's like some like leprechaun version of Robin Hood that like that sounds so dumb to me.
Well, like,
do I've got your fucking
yeah. It's like I take your ring, madam. Like that's
he does
kind
not,
of...
that's not a line in the movie. You just made that up. That's just what it felt like to you when he did it.
Yeah, he actually was like, I'll take your ring.
No, he says, a woman of your beauty has no need of such ornaments. And then he gives her a thing and takes it.
And she's like, ooh, yeah, take my ring. But his speech, like that big, when he's firing everybody up, his big patent speech. And he's like, well, what will we do? And he's like, we'll take it back.
Sheriff's taking all they got, too.
And by God, we take it back.
It's just so funny, like, especially because like everybody in the audience is like, what will we do, Robin? What will we do?
We ain't got nothing to eat.
Yeah, and he's like, well, then we'll take it back.
What do we need that the forest does not provide?
Exactly.
All right, so I think that wraps up our conversation on Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. I want to thank my older brother, Caleb, for joining us for this lovely little chat.
I'd also like to thank my cousin, Caleb, for coming on to Film with Family to talk about one of your favorite movies and giving me a new perspective on a movie that, frankly, I thought was robbing my time.
Rude.
Your way to hell!
Yeah, Caleb's gonna throw you out a window next time he sees you.
I had a great time. I love the podcast. Can't wait to hear the future episodes. Hopefully this episode isn't as long as the too long apparently movie that it's analyzing.
Yeah, we're deep diving here. I'm not just going to give you some surface level conversation about Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. There's a lot going on.
Although, to be fair, we did talk about his accent for probably 3 hours.
Yeah, thanks, Austin, for doing all that research on this movie that you hate, apparently. Appreciate you going the extra mile and doing your research.
That Pierce Brosnan stuff was great.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I think we should sign off this whole episode with a little Pierce Brosnan.
Oh, yeah, we got to plug, we should plug that we are on Instagram now. We got Film with Family on Instagram and Twitter. So give that a follow.
You got to have the theme behind that, pumping this up. That'll make it so epic. All right, now go.
Subscribe to our podcast wherever you get your podcasts and follow us on Instagram and Twitter. Our handle is @FilmWithFamily. I still can't believe we got that handle for both Twitter and Instagram. Nobody thought to do Film with Family, but we did.
Yeah.
And that's where we're at.
That's a great idea. I love my family and I love the movies. Also, you can follow me and Austin on Letterboxd as well if you want to see what movies we're watching in real time.
Yeah, I love you guys. Thanks for talking about Robin Hood. And Caleb, thanks for joining us on Film with Family. We'll see you next week. Bye.
Good evening. I'm Pierce Brosnan. He is a legend that goes by many names. The Earl of Huntington, Robin of Locksley, Robert Fitzooth, and Robert Hood. But to centuries of storytellers, he is simply Robin Hood.